Simon & Schuster Audio presents Shanghai, a novel by Joseph Kanon, read by Jonathan Davis.
For Juliet and Lily. Chapter 1. Trieste, 1939. He was only a few blocks from the hotel when he realized he was being followed. The sudden rain had emptied the big square, so there were only a few scattered umbrellas, no crowd to melt into. Footsteps you could hear, keeping a steady pace with his. When he stopped by one of the street lamps, haloed in the misty drizzle, the footsteps stopped too. Not professional, then. In Berlin, they'd be almost on top of you before you knew, your skin tingling with it, the fear. But maybe the Italians weren't as well trained, or maybe he was imagining it. So close now. Escape just hours away, alert to any sound, ears turned up like a dog's. Still, he'd be better off in the lighted street across the square. In the empty piazza, he'd be easier to grab, hustled off before a solitary walker could lift his umbrella to see what was going on. Unless it was all nerves. His last night, the boat already at the pier, waiting for morning and the desperate passengers, a new life, any life. The piazza was like a stage set of Europe, everything he was leaving behind. The old shipping offices and insurance companies as weighty as imperial ministries. At the far end, open to the Adriatic, cafes once filled with passengers having the last mocha before boarding, official cargo boxes stamped KUK, Kaiser und König, the port of an empire that would last forever, already gone. The steps again, keeping up. An amateur. But hadn't he been too? All of them, everybody in the group. Wanting to do something to stop what was coming? Enemies of the Reich. Remember two things, Franz had said. You have to survive or the rest of it won't matter, so don't take chances. Two, someone will betray you, so don't give him anything to betray. Your real name, who you are. You're just someone in the group. Party discipline. It had worked for Franz, still alive, so they listened, became careful, because just being in the group now was a death warrant. And when Willie was caught, the training held. There was nobody to betray, not even when they tortured him. False names, nothing more to give, until he was dead and they were safe. The only weak link, ironically, was Franz himself. He had recruited the group, knew who they really were, so when they arrested Franz, who had given him away? Someone in the party. Daniel felt the air go out of his chest, a vice squeezing his ribs, one night, then two, imagining the basement in Prince Albrechtstrasse, the screams, the blood on the floor. Then they came for Joseph, because Franz had been broken, given them someone. Another night, sweating, staring at the ceiling. He'd be next. But they didn't come. And then Franz was dead, his body pulp, and Daniel knew he'd been saved. For what? To finally join the party? Did he owe Franz that? In the end, he did nothing, ignored the faint signals Joachim sent, fell out of the group. First you had to survive. And by that time, Kristallnacht had happened, fires leaping out of the smashed windows, and his father beaten and thrown into a truck, collecting Jews for Sachsenhausen, and he knew he had to get out of Germany. Now everyone knew it. The lines at the consular offices, the waiting lists that stretched years into the future, no Jews, not even for money. You could buy a visa to the Dominican Republic and then you couldn't. Uncle Nathan finally arranged it, the impossible tickets, the exit visas. Blood was blood. Was it Nathan's fault his brother Eli was the way he was? Save your skin. China's still open. You don't have to stay in Germany. All this through emissaries from the real underground in Berlin, not the communists, the criminal world Nathan knew and Daniel's father Eli despised. But then it didn't matter what his father thought, his body just ashes somewhere in the camp. Sudden illness, the official notice said. So Daniel would make the trip alone, if he got out. What had happened to Ellie's ticket? Resold, probably, pocketed by Uncle Nathan's fixer. Worth a fortune now. He glanced toward the pier where the SS Raffaello was being loaded. The vice pressed his ribs in again, the moist air caught in his throat. Only a few more hours, and someone following. He passed the big fountain and left the square by the old stock exchange, another imperial flourish, drawn by the lights of the cafes that lined the canal farther along. A thief would prefer shadows. But what was there to steal? If the Germans let you go now, they took everything, bank accounts, property, passport. 10 Reichsmarks in a suitcase, the clothes on your back, and your life. A fair trade. No papers. A meaningless Nansen passport for an ID. A citizen of the Lloyd Triestino line until you reached Shanghai, where you wouldn't even be that. So what was there to steal? But a thief wouldn't know that. Daniel started walking faster toward the safety of the lights, another Canal Grande, but not like the real one, broad and dazzling. Here it was a narrow inlet of nearly stagnant water, just enough movement to rock the boats that tied up along its edges. Melancholy, like the rest of the city. Even the lights reflecting on the water slightly dim. At the door he looked over his shoulder. Which one? Nondescript wool jackets and cloth hats, nobody meeting his eye. Maybe gone. Already looking for another victim. The cafe was a postcard of old Vienna, bent wood chairs and newspaper rods and the hiss of steam from the coffee maker. Daniel took a seat, watching the door. No one. A waiter in a long apron took his order. Why not a last seed cake? Who knew what the ship food would be like? Probably rich and heavy. First class, the only tickets left. Another debt to Nathan. Daniel sat back, his eyes still on the door, feeling calmer. How could it be the Gestapo? There was no one left to give him away. Just footsteps in the dark, imagining things. And then there he was, coming through the door, shaking the rain off his hat, a quick glance around the room, then looking straight at Daniel, almost a smile. He made a you-don't-mind gesture at the other chair and sat down. Hello, he said, not waiting for an answer. You like to walk in the rain? I thought maybe he's meeting somebody. Another glance around the room. But no, just a walk. So it's better here. I didn't want to talk at the hotel. Maybe somebody sees.
Somebody who?
The police.
Daniel looked up. Who are you? What do you want?
The man patted the air with his hand, calming it. Nothing, nothing. It's just a job. Make sure everything's all right. If you need anything.
What would I need?
The man shrugged. People need things. Somebody wants to make sure who.
But who else could it be? Another emissary.
I don't know. It's better. A man who works with me says, do me a favor, make sure he gets on the boat. That's all.
Daniel tried to place the accent as mongrel as Trieste, German, and Italian, and something flinty like the karst that overlooked the city.
I can get on the boat myself.
So, get on yourself, but meanwhile, little advice?
You're a Jew, I assume.
Half, Daniel said, a reflex.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.